Hello, value investors. Thank you for joining me. My name is Michael from Deep Value Returns on Seeking Alpha. Today, I want to talk about Peloton. So why Peloton is kind of a mixed bag investment. We're going to talk about the positive aspects, namely its revenue growth rate. Then we're going to talk about something that's quite negative in terms of its path to profitability. And then we're going to bring this all together and talk about its valuation. So here's the good news, right? So if you're a Peloton shareholder, you will have known that Q1 of 21 was a particularly tough comp. So the revenue growth rate there was more than 230%. So with that in mind, when Q4 came out and they guided for Q1 of next year to be growing at 7%, investors are kind of like, okay, fine. That was always going to be a very tough comp. It's always going to be a challenge to come up against that. You have gyms reopening, you know, coming off a very large base is always going to be quite difficult. And, you know, you've got a lot of competitors as well selling home fitness equipment, which I'll come to in a minute. So with all that considered, investors are saying, okay, give us some guidance beyond that. And after that, you know, we'll come to terms with whatever's happening. And you can see beyond that, the company is guiding to grow at approximately mid, let's say, probably come in at 35% year over year growth rates. So that's quite positive, you know, and that's one of the bullish aspects here at play. The other thing that I want to talk about is that, you know, they are guiding and they're saying, okay, so we have this kind of the whole investment thesis is on its the connected fitness, the subscription business model. And the subscription business model right now is coming at approximately 30%. So on the gross profit margins is coming at approximately 70% of Peloton's gross margins is coming from a subscription business model. So that's a very high margin business that's driving overall gross profit dollars that makes the total gross profits at 70% coming from that very sticky subscription business model. And why it's particularly sticky to me, I was like, okay, this is actually better than I thought, because the churn rate is only 0.7%. So if you think about the number of households that are on a monthly, basically they're all on monthly, everyone's pretty much on a monthly pay to month-to-month subscription, and they just simply don't churn out. So, I mean, if you have a customer base that doesn't churn out and you're just selling them, you know, you just charge them for the subscription, that's a very, very attractive business model. And if you look here, so the gross profits on the subscription business is approximately 64-63% kind of round about that range. And it's, you know, if you think about it, that's really, really attractive. That's kind of like, kind of comparable to other SaaS business models. On the other side of the equation, you got to think that they're selling you a bicycle or whatever, you know, like a treadmill. And that's really, really capital intensive. And the gross margin there is really kind of flat around about mid-teens, you know. So what they're trying to tell you is, okay, yes, we do have to sell that kind of expensive hardware, but then customers really don't churn out and they stick around for a long time. So it's not quite, let's say, in the, like Roku, that is Roku is selling you, the cheap hardware, and then you kind of stick around on Roku's business model, on Roku's platform. It's not quite like that, but that's the kind of mindset that some people are kind of looking at Peloton and saying that's kind of similar. You can buy into that or not, that's up to you, but anyway, I just wanted to put it out there. So as the year progresses and its guidance for the year ahead, they're kind of taking a step back in terms of EBITDA profitability. So for the last two years, EBITDA has been approximately 6%, and now they're saying, okay, for the year ahead, we're gonna go into negative 6%. So it's quite a swing towards negative profitability. On the other hand, they're probably being a bit conservative right there, so it probably ends up being at negative 4%. But for all intents and purposes, you know, investors are still having to digest and then kind of come to terms with, in the past, this was a company in the last year that was being quite profitable, and then as we look ahead, it's taking a step back. So, I mean, it's kind of that, you know, it's a bit of a mixed bag, really. The other thing that I want to talk about is the stock is priced at 6x forward sales. So if you value this as a hardware business, 6x forward sale is expensive. If you value this as a kind of a subscription business, 6x forward sale is quite cheap. On the other side of the equation, you have to keep in mind that if you look at something like Nautilus. Nautilus is a competitor to Peloton, but Nautilus, you know, the subscription business model of Nautilus is only approximately 8% of it is actually the subscription business, and the rest is just hardware business. Nonetheless, that's priced at approximately 4x operating profits for this year. So yes, you know, it's a more of a commodity business, but that's really showing to, you know, just another point of reference that if Peloton is a cyclical business and, you know, this other business is similarly is priced just 4x operating profits, is it worthwhile really be paying 6x forward sales for Peloton? So, I mean, yes, on the other side of the equation, you say, okay, Peloton is a brand and nearly 70% of its gross profits are coming from a very, very sticky business, from a very, very sticky subscription business. So it's kind of some puts and takes. Overall, I'm not particularly excited about this stock right now, and I think there are better opportunities. And if you want to find out what kind of stocks I'm buying into right now, come and check out my marketplace. It's called Deep Value Returns. I'll tell you the stocks I own. You're welcome to do a totally free trial to see if it suits you. Come in, check it out, talk to our investment community, and check out the references on the marketplace. You know, you can read through what other people have given 5 stars for the marketplace, and you're welcome to unsubscribe anytime before the 14 days if you find that it doesn't resonate with you. And as I say always, you know, I'm not really going to substitute what you do. I'm just a place of ideas that you're going to kind of pick and choose one or two stocks someone's done some due diligence on. And if you haven't got the time or inclination to get involved, if you're new to investing, come and check out my marketplace called Deep Value.